Good morning and welcome to the 8th meeting of the Social Justice and Social Security Committee. This morning we will be discussing kinship care with a range of stakeholders. Apologies have been received from Alina Whittam and Emma Roddick, and Evelyn Tweed is attending as Alina's substitute. As Deputy Convener, I will be convening this morning's meeting. Our first item of business today is a decision to take items 3 and 4 in private. Are we all agreed? Thank you. All right, we'll move on to agenda item 2. I welcome to the meeting our first panel who are joining us remotely. Hello all. I'll welcome Kirsty Doyle, Permanence Lead for Celsus, Laura Caven, Children and Young People Team COSLA, Vivian Thompson, Social Work Scotland, and Linda Richards, Perth and Kinross Council. A few housekeeping points to mention before we start. I would ask that please allow our broadcasting colleagues a few seconds to turn your microphones on before you start to speak. All witnesses can indicate with an R in the dialogue box in blue jeans or simply with a show of your hand if you wish to come in a question. And everyone should check that they can see the dialogue box on the right-hand side of your screen. I would ask everybody to be mindful of time this morning. We do have a lot to get through. Please don't feel that you have to answer every single question. And if you've nothing new to add to what's been said by other people, that's okay. You're also welcome to follow up in writing on any points that you don't feel have been covered, that you might have missed, or if you want to supply any further information at all on any point raised after the meeting. I would just reaffirm, please, short, succinct questions and answers. And I would also invite all members to direct their questions to particular panellists. So I will begin with Jeremy. I believe you want to come in.
Thank you. Good morning and good morning to the panel. Thank you all for coming along this morning. I've got a couple of questions just to start us off with. And probably this will be aimed at CIS as it's part of your submission. I was interested to read from your submission and from other submissions that there does seem to be some confusion around the words formal and informal in regard to kinship care, and the categories don't seem to be neatly defined. I wonder if you can maybe help me out by saying, is that just the way it's always going to be, or is there work that we can do to give better definitions, and does that actually make a difference in practice?
Do you have anyone specific you're directing that to? Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, I think it's on a really important point, and I think it's a good question that to start some of these discussions this morning. I think the use of phrases such as formal and informal to describe kinship care can be a little bit confusing, and it's a really good opportunity to discuss that today. And I think they can be used as different categories to describe different families whose needs and circumstances may be similar. And yet, based on these categories, it can mean that vital support is much harder to access for some carers than others. So, for example, informal arrangements can often be those where a court order is in place. And so sometimes that can feel a little bit tricky to describe them as informal arrangements. And similarly, some formal arrangements do not involve, for example, an order granted by the children's hearing system and are based on the consent of a parent, for example, under a voluntary agreement through Section 25 of the Children's Scotland Act 1995. So I think the use of formal and informal is definitely something that we'd want to explore. And I think it's certainly something we'd want to think about further, because I think we really need to get into thinking about what does this child need, rather than what is the status of the adult who cares for them and what is the legal arrangement around them. It really helps us to step into what does this child need if we strip away some of those definitions.
Thank you. That's helpful. I don't know if anyone else got anything they want to add to that question. If not, I'll move on, Convener, to a question in regard to, and again, this maybe is one for COSLA to start with. Obviously, we had the promise, it was published back in 2017, and then reporting on 2018. I'm just wondering, what progress do you think has been made in regard to reforms that were outlined? And going forward, what are the major ones that we now need to pick up on and move forward at a quicker pace?
Can I clarify, are you specifically referring to kinship care reforms in relation to kinship care when you're talking about the promise or the promise overall?
Yeah, just in regard to kinship care.
There's quite a lot, and actually it relates to your earlier question in terms of definitions around the different definitions of kinship carers. Because as the previous speaker said, we need to start to think about what the child needs. In fact, we are starting to think about, and we have been for a while under GRFIC, what the child needs rather than the legal status of their carer and the placement. So I think within the Kinship Care Collaborative, there's a bit of work going on under some of the subgroups around looking at the gaps in terms of any resourcing needs or any of the support that's provided to families, regardless of the definition. So that's definitely one of the things that we'll need to focus on going forward, is just removing, looking at the definition and looking at actually what the child needs. And there's good work going on there, but that's something that we need to accelerate.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. I'd now like to bring in Marie McNair to be followed by Miles Briggs.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. I'll pose my first question to Laura Cavan from COSLA and anyone else who'd like to comment. We're seeing considerable variation in rates of support for kinship carers across councils. What are the main reasons for this? And are you concerned that the needs of some kinship carers are not being met because of the variations in policy?
Thanks for that question. That's a live one, certainly. There's a range of reasons for that, and one of them is the fact that, as well as the core allowances that are paid, there are local authorities have a range of different payments and benefits in place for kinship carers, foster carers. For example, they have different payments for celebrations, for birthdays and things like that, or for clothing or for transport. So looking at the core allowances in isolation doesn't give you a clear picture of the overall financial support that's available. As well as that, you've got the different costs depending on the different area that you live in. For example, you'll know that there are significant variations in the cost of transport, fuel, things like that, distance to be travelled, depending on where you live. However, in saying that, there is work ongoing, and you'll know from our submission and from everyone else's submissions as well, that the Care Allowances Group reported 2018, and there's been work going on since then, although paused a little bit during the initial part of the pandemic, to look at how we make sure that there's a bit more clarity around allowances, to make sure that families understand and have the resources that they need to support their children. That work has picked up again, and we're looking at not just the core allowances, but the other support that's around that, to make sure that everything is clear. Scottish Government are looking at the funding that can be provided to support that. But yes, looking at the allowances in isolation isn't a clear picture of the financial support. Vivian might want to add a bit more on that, because she's been involved in this work as well.
Yeah, I mean, I would just echo what Laura has already said. The issue of financial support, there's several reasons why it varies. Scotland is the only one of the four nations that doesn't have national allowance for foster care, and Scotland has pegged our kinship allowances to our fostering allowances. Historically, there were national recommended rates that came from both COSLA and from Fostering Network about what allowance should be paid for young people. That has dissipated over time, and local authorities set their own fostering rates now. And the national allowance work was about bringing us in line with the other three nations of the UK and bringing greater equity to foster carers and eligible kinship carers, so that the same rate would be paid regardless of whether you live in the north of Scotland or in one of the cities or in the central belt. And that's very much something that certainly Social Work Scotland are supportive of. As Laura says, there's been a lot of work going on about looking at what a reasonable allowance would be, looking at different models that have been used for that, and there is a lot of work going on just now to try and bring that whole discussion to a conclusion, which would mean that there was equity of allowance across the country. That some of that includes what an allowance should cover, the details of that, and it's equally applicable to kinship carers as it is to foster carers.
Thank you for that. I've just got a second question. Across the 32 councils, approaches are different. What has been done to promote best practice? Is there any good approach you're aware of that you'd like to highlight to the committee?
To good practice for finance?
Yep. Uh-huh.
That's quite a difficult question to respond to. There are different approaches across the country. What there is a real commitment across local authorities and voluntary groups and others who work with kinship carers and with foster carers about making sure that carers receive the support that they actually need. The GIRFEC framework that Kirsty referred to earlier on is universally embedded, and it is about assessing what do young people need, as distinct from, you know, this is what we will give to them. So there's not one model that would fit everything. But what there is that real desire that the right support is given at the right time. There are some legal complexities to making sure that happens, because as you'll see from the papers that have been submitted, there's lots of variances and differences that in what people are entitled to, depending on legal status, that actually makes kinship care quite a complicated situation. But there's certainly a commitment amongst people to make sure that people get the right support, and some quite imaginative ways of using other means to help kinship carers access, for example, family support, join foster carer training, do access charities, manage other approaches in that way. I'm not sure if that's specifically answered your question. I think it does play into the additional support that can be provided to kinship carers other than just within the allowance.
No, that's been helpful. Can you just one final question, if that's okay? I just throw it out to anyone that can answer. But frequently, our committee hear horror stories about the detrimental impact of universal credit. How is UC impacting on kinship carers, and is there anything that urgently needs to be addressed? And I appreciate that obviously the second panel might be able to answer that in more detail.
Would anybody from the panel like to come in, or are you directing that to anybody specific, Marie?
No, I'll just put it out to anyone that can answer on the panel, thanks. But if not, it's certainly something I can take up in the next panel, thanks.
I am not seeing anyone wanting to come in that, so I think we'll maybe leave that to the second panel. Is that all your questions, Marie?
That's me for now, thanks.
All right, thank you very much. I'll move now to Miles Briggs, and to be followed by Jeremy Balfour.
Thank you. Good morning to the panel. Thank you for joining us this morning. I wanted to carry on some of the questions there, which Marie McNairn opened with, because I wanted to ask specifically why we haven't seen progress on this, because I think there is frustration in the Parliament, to be quite frank as well, because the Education Committee's work on this did put forward so many many recommendations which doesn't seem to have actually taken place. So specifically looking at the Scottish recommended allowance, is that purely because of a financial situation councils are finding themselves in? I was looking at the COSLA's submission to the committee, which states that from the start of the work on a national allowance, for example, that it would not be possible to deliver that within current levels of funding, and that the Scottish Government, having cut council funding, would have to fully fund that for that to be possible. So I'll maybe bring in Laura in terms of why we haven't seen that standard delivered, because it's years now since that was expected.
Thanks. So there's a range of reasons for that. I mean, if we go back to when the recommendations were first published, then there was a great deal of work done at that point to cost what that would, what the recommended allowance would be, what the financial impact of that would be. And I understand that at that point, Scottish Government were a way to discuss how they would provide the funding to allow for that. And then, obviously, with COVID-19, there was a bit of a delay as people rightly turned their attention to the immediate crisis. I would say, though, that over the past few months, discussions have picked up again. And I understand the frustrations fully. And I think Vivienne and I, having been involved in this for a while, might echo some of those frustrations as well. But we are in a place now where we're moving forward with that, so I hope that that offers some level of reassurance. As well as that, it is a complex area, as I described in my last response to your colleague, because as well as the core allowances that local authorities are paying, there are a range of other payments that local authorities are making to foster and kinship carers to support the children that they're looking after. So it isn't the case that we can just look at the allowances in isolation. We also need to ensure that there's equity. So if a council is paying above what the recommended allowance would be, we don't want to see the foster care, kinship carer losing out in any way, because like the allowance being reduced in any area. So we want to make sure that it's fully funded, that anyone paying below is able to pay that allowance, but anyone paying above it isn't negatively impacted. And so basically we need a distribution that doesn't penalise those that are paying over the recommended allowance. So that's added a bit of complexity to it as well. Wasn't very succinct or clear. I do apologise. Happy to have another bash at that or send you over some additional information.
Thank you. That would be very helpful. And I think for the committee, probably, if there's information about what additional payments other councils do provide and what that looks like, I think that would be really helpful as well to see where clearly there's a postcode lottery then in that case of what support's being provided across the country. I'm not sure if anyone else had said they wanted to come in on that question. I can't see.
No, I don't believe anyone else would.
Just to move on to a second question, it was also with regards to kinship carers who are in informal kinship care arrangements and obviously who are not eligible at this moment in time for support. I wanted to ask, and maybe this is a good question to bring in Linda Richards, how that these individuals are supported and what arrangements, for example, you have in place in Perth and Kinross Council.
Good morning. Thanks for the question. I guess what I would, first of all, be wanting to make clear is that informal kinship care arrangements are for children who are not looked after by the local authority. And as such, it's a very difficult balance to strike, really, because what we don't want to be doing is impinging on the right to their family and have, and under the Children Scotland Act, is have that minimal intervention focus as well. The informal kinship care arrangements we have in Perth and Kinross is obviously through the Kinship Care Assistance Act. We did a lot of publicity around about local arrangements in terms of if there were kinship care arrangements that we weren't aware of, and there are many kinship carers out there who are looking after family members in private family arrangements that don't actually want the state to intervene. And I think what we have tried to do is offer that on a kind of voluntary basis, so offer the support, and it is an offer rather than a must do, and used our local partners, third sector partners within Perth and Kinross to offer the support that sometimes they don't want from a social work department. Because I think we also have to be clear about that, is that a lot of informal arrangements are made by families who don't want formal social work support. So therefore, directing them through the third sector partnerships, that is what supports them. So things like we have a dedicated access to our welfare rights team that will allow them to ensure that their benefits are maximised. We also ensure that any kind of housing requirements, we have a strategic need policy within Perth and Kinross for kinship carers, and therefore they get strategic need points, which allows them to access larger housing. We also do a lot of training and support through our therapeutic project, so we can sometimes offer individual consultation regarding emotional wellbeing, mental health issues for children, young people living in kinship care, to the kinship carers themselves. So I guess the financial support is different, but the actual practical and emotional support is what our experiences that these group of kinship carers are really looking for. We have also supported a number of them to financially manage to gain the kinship care order, which allows for them to gain the parental rights and responsibilities of the children that they're looking after. And several kinship, informal kinship carers have come forward and sought that financial support, and we have given that to them. So I think what is different about informal kinship care, in summary, is really that is dictated by a lot by the kinship carer themselves, in seeking what it is that they want and what they are feeling they need in order to look after the child.
Thank you. That's really helpful and informative. Just finally, I wanted to ask, and it's on that specific... Sorry.
Ian wanted to come in on that, sorry, before you move on to your next.
Thanks.
Yes, it was just to add a little bit to what Linda Richards had already said. This links to the questions that were asked earlier about definition as well, in that not all informal carers do not receive the allowance. Some eligible kinship carers do receive an allowance, and that's probably the part of the legislative framework within which we operate the kinship carers that causes the most confusion. Because you do have two carers sitting with a kind of Section 11 kinship care order, but one will get an allowance and one will not get an allowance. And that depends on whether, they were at risk of being accommodated, whether they were placed originally with the kinship carer by the local authority, any involvement with the local authority. So there is a difference there in just the support that is provided financially to some of those kinship carers. So some will be getting an allowance and the support that Linda has described. Others will be getting the support that Linda has described, but might be receiving their maintenance income from benefits or from other sources.
Thank you for that. And it leads on to my point, which I wanted to make, which I know, and I'm sure every MSP has had these cases, that often it will be grandparents who in many cases have retired sometimes and who are informally taking on the kinship care role. And I think, to go back to what you were saying, Linda, people are often then worried about engaging with social work and what that might mean and how that might see them judged sometimes, to be quite honest. So I wanted to ask, in terms of looking at a future model, whether or not informal kinship carers should also, look to benefit from a recommended allowance, and how, given your experience, what that would look like and how that could work for these families who often, I think, are nervous about engaging with local authorities on these issues. I'm not sure if anyone wants to comment on that. Linda?
Yeah, I'm quite happy to comment on that. I think Well, first of all, what I would say is that obviously the ambitions of the promise is about universal family support. And I think that is the key in supporting informal kinship carers. Whether, as Vivian has spoken about, we in Pettingford and Ross call them wellbeing enhanced carers, in order to differentiate from those carers, that group of informal kinship carers who have previously had been caring for a looked after child and then have gained a kinship care order and therefore still may require some support and will still be entitled to an allowance, as opposed to informal kinship carers where we have had no previous involvement with. And I think what I would say that the universal supports that are in the community is what the informal kinship carers require and need more than the intervention of local authorities via the social work department. So we are looking at building those kind of universal supports through our education colleagues, through our support networks with our third sector partners, to raise the profile of kinship carers that possibly require more support than children, young people who are their peers. So I think it is about, if there was an allowance that was to be in the future, I would like to see that as a kind of universal support rather than through the council, where the social work department would be involved in the monitoring and allocation of that.
Thank you.
I believe Laura wants to come in on that point.
Thanks, convener. I was to pick up on the point around families perhaps being reluctant to access support or feeling worried about accessing support. That's part of the reason that we're puzzled quite strongly stating that children's services should not be included in the National Care Service as it was in the consultation, because if the promise is about supporting families and reducing barriers, and we spent years trying to destigmatise the kind of support seeking and receiving support from a range of agencies and providing that support through universal services like schools, like ELC, trying to make that kind of a holistic, you know, GIRFIC whole family kind of support. And we don't want to risk undoing that by moving that kind of support into a National Care Service. So just to reiterate that point there.
Thanks very much, Laura. I'll now bring in Jeremy Balfour to be followed by Fausto Chowdhury.
Thanks again, convener. I wonder if I can come back to this point about a national agreed allowance. Obviously, you know, we are a country of around about 5 million. We know each other quite well. Going forward, is it more sensible just to pay this centrally by national government rather than leaving local authorities with the discretion of how much they pay, what extra should be paid? Should this be brought as a Scottish Government, that if you do kinship care, this is what you get, whether you live in Inverness or Dumfries or whoever in the world? And perhaps I could start with Kirsty and then Vivian, and if anyone else wants to jump in, that would be helpful.
Thank you. I think, as we've talked about a little bit today, we know that often children living with kinship carers are disproportionately living in some of the poorest households in Scotland. And so the provision of financial support to kinship carers is crucial. And equally crucial to that is the implementation of such a national minimal allowance for kinship carers, we feel is required quite urgently. And one of the risks of becoming a kinship carer is that it can cause financial difficulties, as being described earlier, due to the additional costs of raising a child, especially if there are extra supports needed, for example, as a result of children's complex life experiences, there might be a need for therapeutic and really trauma-informed supports. We also know that often grandparents, as has been spoken about before, are the most frequent kinship carers,
who may be living within limited means already. We also know from a recent survey that 44% of kinship carers feel they have to give up their employment when they become a kinship carer. So obviously there is a real need for financial aspect of becoming a kinship carer to really be addressed.
Yeah, just to kind of add to what Kirsty has said, I think that's a really interesting question, and certainly there is universal support across local authorities, support groups, etc., that the introduction of a national allowance across Scotland would be not just a desirable, that is something that we very much want to see happening. Within Scotland. In the other three nations, it is an allowance which relates to fostering, and it would only be if you were approved or assessed as a foster carer that that allowance would come. Scotland's situation is slightly different in that there was a kind of parity of allowances that was brought in by the Scottish Government a number of years ago. I'm forgetting what particular date that is. At the time of the decision to make eligible kinship carers and kinship carers have looked after children entitled to the same allowance as their foster carer counterparts was brought in, there was also a commitment by the Scottish Government to look at the position that welfare benefits would take in providing a much more equitable approach to support to kinship carers. And that is something which we would certainly hope could be explored further, particularly now that the Scottish Government has got the Social Security Scotland aspect of their provision there. Regardless of the introduction of a national allowance for foster carers that will equally be applied to eligible kinship carers, there will remain inequity. And that's because of the legal context that we spoke about earlier, that some carers are eligible for an allowance the same as the foster carers and some are not. So if we really want to look at what the promise is talking about in terms of equity of support, family support, being able to have your needs met regardless of what part of the country you are living in, that feels particularly important.
Thank you. My final question is, what further support do you think would make the biggest impact in supporting kinship carers across Scotland? So if there was kind of one thing you asked, you could do tomorrow, what would it be? And perhaps you could just go around the panel and start with Linda.
For me, the one thing that would make the biggest difference is suitable housing. And across certainly in our local authority, I mean, naturally, whilst we've all spoken about, the majority of kinship arrangements involve grandparents, there is also a number of families where there are four or five children, being placed with grandparents or with aunts and uncles who also have children of their own. So accessing suitable housing becomes then a huge issue, and there's not many 5-6 bedroom local authority homes that are available for kinship carers. We have done very imaginative things and knocked together two flats to make one house for a family group of eight children moving in to live with their grandparents. But that is not always possible, and comes with a risk for a financial risk as well. So housing for me is a huge issue.
Thank you, Linda. Can we take Kirsty next, to be followed by Laura?
Yes, thank you. I mean, I would agree with what Linda has just said about housing. I think that's absolutely crucial. I think for me, one of my big things I would like to see are clearer assessment and decision-making processes in local authorities and their partners for children who have a plan to or are already living with kinship carers. Now, obviously, Linda has the experience of Perth and Kinross, which I think is exemplary, but we know also that
there is huge variation across Scotland in the approach, assessment and decision-making processes for children in kinship care. And this is particularly stark even where those children in kinship care are, quote, looked after under the legislation, and they should, by that definition, have regular looked after child reviews in the same way as other looked after children do, for example, who are living in foster care or with prospective adopters. And the reason these processes and scrutiny are so important is that it's really part of ensuring that children are living with the most suitable carers, which is obviously what we want, who will meet their needs for the rest of their childhood and hopefully beyond. And those carers and children continue to receive that appropriate and tailored support that they need for those children to thrive. And I think sometimes as well, within these assessment and decision-making processes, there isn't always the same legal advice offered to kinship carers or discussion about various options. Sometimes there's an assumption that a kinship care order is the best option without really exploring other legal routes, that actually might be more beneficial for some specific children and their kinship carers. So I suppose I would really advocate for clearer assessment and decision-making processes to make sure that children and their kinship carers get the support they need, both at the point of decision-making and beyond.
Thank you. Can we just bring Laura in now to be followed by Vivian? Thanks.
Certainly. Thanks, Convener. I wouldn't disagree with anything that previous panel members have said there. If there was one thing, I suppose, that I would like to see happen tomorrow, as I was asked, I think enhancing and accelerating the culture change around how people do and feel about receiving support or accessing support, relating to what members and Linda have spoken about in terms of reluctance to seek support, and that's in line with the promise and making sure that we provide that support early to avoid any kind of struggle or crisis situations and help children thrive regardless of their family situation. And if I can add also that we would like to see that the full funding of the Scottish recommended allowance, while allowing for that important local variation, as I mentioned earlier, there are different costs associated with living in different parts of Scotland in different situations. So I'll take two of those. Two options, if that's okay.
Thanks, Laura. And just finally, Vivian, thanks.
Thank you. Yes, and similarly, I wouldn't disagree with anything that my colleagues have already said. I think the one thing that I would like to see would be really good quality family support that is available to everybody and available to every kinship carer. That's a core component of what we're trying to achieve through the promise. And what we hear from kinship carers across the country is that money is important, but equally important is the other support that's around, the support to be able to access suitable housing, to be able to adjust the housing that they're in just now, to have access to support to understand how they care for a child who's been perhaps traumatised or had difficult experiences, to be able to have somebody they can go to say, how do I get extra support at school because my young person is struggling, they're having difficulties, I don't understand what that's about. Just all these different aspects of family support, and if that was universally available, it would make such a difference to every kinship carer, regardless of whether they're looking after a looked after child, an informal carer who's receiving an allowance, or an informal carer who's never had any contact with social work at all. So that would be my wish if I had a magic wand for tomorrow.
Thank you, Jeremy. Just prior to moving on to Foisel, I believe Evelyn Tweed has a question on one of the points raised within this theme. Evelyn, I'll bring you in now. Thanks.
Okay, thanks, Convener. And good morning, panel. Yes, it was to go back to a point that Linda Richards had made about housing. I thought that was a really powerful point you made, Linda, when you said that there just aren't enough large houses within your area for kinship carers. I see that myself locally in Stirling, And I wondered if the committee needs to look at the point of, you know, there's a huge Scottish Government house building programme, but at local level, local authorities need to consider kinship carers and their needs, and this particular need for quite large housing. And I would direct that to Linda.
I would say that certainly, I mean, certainly I speak to my colleagues across the country, and this is an issue that is obviously in Stirling, but also Perth and Ross and across the country. And I think, yes, absolutely. We have a really strong partnership in Perth and Ross with our housing colleagues who go above and beyond to try and find us houses that are suitable for kinship carers. There just aren't enough sometimes, but yes, they are totally aware of the need to, and we'll look at all different kinds of options, and you know, we'll help with extensions, and we had a partner, a housing association, who you know allowed us to reconvert the top floor of their house to make four bedrooms out of three. So we've got lots of examples of, you know, people really working hard to try and make sure that this happens. But yes, absolutely, we just need to make sure that it's a priority and building more larger homes.
Thank you.
In the right area.
Yes, absolutely.
Thanks both. I'll now bring in Fossil Chowdhury to be followed by Miles Briggs.
Thank you very much, convener. Good morning, panel. I just wanted to, I think my colleagues have already asked, and I want to go back to that topic again. I mean, it's for the panel, anyone can answer that question, I guess. What barriers exist to informal kinship carriers gaining the benefits to which they are entitled, and what are the problems that you see with the current system of entitlements?
Would you like to direct that to a member of the panel, Fossil?
Linda or Vivian? I think Linda will be the one. I can see she's shaking her head.
Yeah. Are you thinking about financial entitlements or the entitlements to support, or both?
For both, I would say. I mean, mostly financial.
Yeah. I mean, the financial, I think sometimes, our experience has been that sometimes informal kinship carers don't know that they are entitled to welfare benefits and support towards the granting of the kinship or a kinship care order. So part of the barrier is about, you know, just making raising awareness round about their entitlements and supporting them to approach the relevant organisations. We have, as I said before, a partnership with our local welfare rights team, who have been excellent in getting alongside our kinship carers who have then done done income maximisation assessments that allows them to sort of ensure that they are receiving all the benefits that they can, that they are entitled to. On several occasions, that has increased kinship carers' financial position quite considerably. So that is one thing that we have tried to do and tried to promote within the kinship carer, the informal kinship carer group. The barrier, I suppose, in terms of thinking about kinship care orders, for those who have not been involved with a kind of formal process of removing the child from their parents, as you would do if they were a looked after child, I think part of the barrier in seeking support to gain kinship care orders is the emotional impact that has on a kinship carer. So if we're talking about a grandparent removing the parental rights and responsibilities from their own child in order to look after their grandchild, that is a huge emotional journey for them, and they need support in order to be able to consider whether that is the right thing to do. Our kinship care team will work through that with them in terms of supporting them and thinking what is it that what is the need, what is the hope to gain. They also, our kinship care team will look at specific things. So we will pay one-off payments to allow for essential equipment like beds, bedding, clothing, those kinds of things that allows the kinship carer to be freed up from that kind of financial burden that allows them to then look after the child themselves. I think partially it is about raising awareness, and we have tried to do that through some of our universal partners and ensuring that if kinship carers come forward, for example, very often the people who know about informal kinship care arrangements are our education colleagues, and we have done a lot of raising awareness, and you know, sometimes we will have referrals into our kinship care team from guidance teachers or other third sector partners that just allows for that support to be considered by them.
Thank you, Linda. Thank you. Faisal, do you have any further questions?
No, thank you very much.
Thank you. Apologies for sticking on the same theme. I'll bring Pam Duncan-Glancy in prior to Miles.
Thank you very much, convener, and good morning, panel. Thank you for your submissions and also for your answers so far, and some of what I was going to speak about, in particular the variation of allowances across the country, which I find quite staggering. You know, for one age group from age 0 to 4, that can be anything from £77 to £200. So the conversation we've had around the need for a national allowance there has been really helpful in that. I just wanted to ask, and possibly Laura, if it's all right, it said in your submission that local authorities are able to choose how they cover the cost of 16 items as part of the allowance. Does that mean that it could, that in some cases it's not a cash payment, or is it always a cash payment for the allowance?
I don't know that I have an answer to that one, actually. That might be one that Vivian, who's a bit closer to the delivery side of things than I am, would be able to answer. What we meant by that in the submission or allow the figures that you're referring to there, there might be an additional payment, for example, in relation to transport that isn't covered in the core allowance. It might be a separate payment. Some of the things might be paid for separately, clothing or something like that, a separate payment for clothing. Whether or not, I assume that it's cash payments for this, but actually I think I might defer to Vivian on that. But what I was meaning in that is that not all 16 might be within that allowance that you're seeing, the figure that you referred to, the figures there. There may be a separate payment made or one of those specific elements.
Thank you.
Yeah, I can answer that. The allowance is a cash allowance, which is given to foster carers or any eligible kinship carers, and it comes in not, I don't hand over notes, but it goes through the BACS payment into kinship carers or foster carers' bank accounts. The national allowance and the 16 items, part of the work of that group, identified what the national allowance ought to cover, and there are 16 items that were listed within that. Across the country, there are variations in what people would call additional payments to foster carers and to kinship carers of looked after children. And it covers things like, the best way to describe it would be to say, if somebody has to travel for a meeting related to the work of looking after that child, they might get an allowance for covering that. Most local authorities will provide what we would call set-up costs. So at the point where somebody first becomes a kinship carer, they would be provided with, you know, bed, bedding, they might need clothing, they might need other immediate costs to ensure that at that point they can actually look after that young person. So there are lots of other little bits and pieces that are provided in terms of support, and they might be provided in cash or they might be provided in kind. You know, it might be an actual bed that is provided, or it might be the money that is provided to the carer to go and purchase the bed of their choice, and that's something that's normally done in relation in discussion. One of the opportunities that we have, which we still need to explore a little bit further, is how much some of the self-directed support legislation might be able to assist. And I think there are particular opportunities with kinship carers in relation to that, that when there's an assessed need, that they actually have much more choice over how that need is then met for, in relation to the young people. But I think that's a subject for a completely new session. Thank you.
Thank you for that. Can I ask one further follow-up, please, convener? Thank you. That's really helpful and really clear. I wonder then if I could ask, what would the impact of have the discussions around the national allowance taken into consideration the rate required for those 16 items? How is it being established? Are we looking at the increases in cost of living as well as part of that? And how do you see that kind of rate and then the payment going forward? I think someone mentioned Social Security Scotland earlier. Do you think that there's a role for them in this going forward?
I'll have a first stab at that, but others might want to come in behind me. Fraser Valander Institute was involved in those initial costings of the kind of 16 items and what that might look like. And there is a report that was provided to the Scottish Government and to the Alliances Working Group that kind of went through all of that. As and when we introduce the national allowance for foster carers and eligible kinship carers, it will be important that there is some kind of cost of living uplift involved in that. We're really serious about making sure that, you know, that the allowance covers everything that is needed for youngsters who are in care or youngsters who are in eligible kinship care. Then it needs to continue to be. There's no point in introducing it and then 2 years later it's actually not sufficient to do what the whole intent of all of this work has been. There has always been a commitment that was stated right back at the beginning of the allowances work, as I said earlier, that there was a role for benefits, and that if there was a way of providing a benefit to all kinship carers, then that would take away from the inequity that currently exists, but also which will still exist even with the introduction of a national allowance, because there are many informal kinship carers who actually will not be able to access that particular allowance. I'm not sure if that answers your question, but I hope it helps.
It absolutely does. And just finally on that, if you will, Vivian, the legal mechanism that is used to determine who's eligible and who's not, could you tell us a bit more about what that mechanism is and what would need to change?
There's two different legal mechanisms there. There's children who, for want of a better word, are in care. So they have been removed from their parents, perhaps by children's hearing, and placed with a kinship carer. And that's something which local authorities have got a duty to do. They should always look at family before they look at any kind of stranger care for obvious reasons. Or it may be that a family member themselves has said, look, I am struggling, can you please look after my young person? You know, for a while. So these children are looked after. It's no different to a young person who might be in foster care or a young person who might be in residential or other types of care. So all the looked after regulations and legislation that govern children in care apply to those children. The informal group, it's a kinship care order, and that's outlined in the Children and Young Person Act 2014. It covers those that are eligible for an allowance are termed, horrible terminology here, but eligible carers and eligible children. And if they meet certain criteria for eligibility, then they will get the allowance. And if they don't, then they will not. The eligibility criteria is about a young person who formerly looked after. So the young people that Linda Richards was talking about earlier, where they have already been looked after with a kinship carer, a decision has been made that that needs to be the permanent place that the child lives, and steps have been taken to support the kinship carer to achieve a Section 11 order which allows them to be permanently cared with that carer, takes them out of the care system, gives the kinship carer parental rights, lets them get on with that, but still allows the local authorities to support them if that is needed. So they're previously looked after, they were at risk of coming into, at risk of accommodation coming into care at the time they were placed, or the other eligibility criteria is gone right out of my head and I should know it. So previously looked after or something else.
Thank you.
Placed with the involvement of the local authorities, sorry. So they might not have been actually in care, but actually the local authority was involved in making that placement. So if these criteria are met, they are considered to be eligible carers and eligible young people and can therefore access the allowance and the other support that goes with that.
Thank you. Thank you, convener.
Thank you, Pam. We'll now move on to our final theme, and I will bring in Miles Briggs, please.
Thank you. I wanted to carry on. It kind of overlaps a lot of the conversation we've had today with regards to further support for kinship families, and specifically looking at referral pathways, signposting, whatever we want to call it, and how we can improve that. We've already touched upon when young people in education, and I just wondered if there is a better model we should be looking towards so that all these professionals, especially teachers, are aware of the needs of kinship carers, but also young carers. I think, you know, there's also an overlap there as well in the classroom setting. And just to look specifically at some of the information which you provided, CELSIS survey, I think, really highlighted the root of some of this with regards to the many children in kinship care having experienced trauma, and also the number of children in kinship care who are less likely to receive mental health support than children in foster care. So I just wondered what your view is on that, and specifically my question is really, how do we improve that model? And in a classroom setting, I think, is maybe where, although we're not the Education Committee, there is an opportunity to take on board some of that work. So a long question, I know, but I'll maybe start with yourself, Vivian, as I think you touched upon this.
I mean, the whole issue of mental health support is a massive topic that's being given a lot of attention. Education and Children and Young Persons committees looked at it, and so have other committees, and it's something which is highlighted within the promise. And anything that can be done to both raise awareness, but also to ensure that the right children are able to access support is, you know, going to be very much welcomed. It's something that's a lot of attention being paid to just now. There are a number of groups looking at mental health support for young people, not only those who are looked after or in kinship, but all young people. And I think on this side of things, actually, if we can sort that for the general population, it will actually sort it for young people in kinship care. If you were talking to people who only worked within fostering and did not work within kinship care, they would actually talk about the challenges that there are in getting access to the right mental health support for young people in foster care. There is a national shortage of access to CAM services, and there's a lot of attention being paid to what you could call crisis services and early intervention services across the country. There's been money put into that. There are plans to expand it. And I do think that that's where we need to put the attention on generally, so that young people, carers, parents, general population actually know that they can access the right help at the right time, regardless of whether they're in foster care or kinship care or living with their parents or struggling with the stress of exams. And the school aspect of that is, in my view, incredibly important. It is the one place where every child, regardless of their living circumstances, regardless of the legal context they might be living within, they are all attending school or registered at some, apart from perhaps from a few homeschool people, they're all accessing education. So the counsellors in schools, the early intervention support that's been provided there, the text chat services that are beginning to develop, an awareness of that is something that, if we pay attention to, could make quite a substantial difference to, you know, young people, including young people who are living in kinship care arrangements, looked after, eligible or not eligible.
Thank you. I'm not sure who else wants to come in, but one issue I wanted to maybe just touch upon was whether or not school, you know, teachers, for example, should be able to be informed of this. For example, you know, on registers having YC beside someone's name to suggest they're a young carer, or KC for kinship care, to basically flag to teachers, especially in a secondary school setting when people are moving around different teachers at different classes, to understand and sometimes cut them some slack. I think that's one of the questions which is always put to me when I'm speaking to young carers. So I just wanted to also include that as part of the question and potential model for anyone else who wants to come in. Thank you.
Thank you. Which member of the panel would like to come in on that?
Linda? I'm quite happy to.
Oh, yep, Linda. Thank you.
I think we're all acutely aware of the impact of the pandemic on our children, young people, emotional health and mental wellbeing. Needs have certainly become more to the fore. I would suggest that within the majority of our schools, the young carers are certainly, recent legislation and policy guidance has absolutely put their needs to the centre. And I think teachers more than ever have been acutely aware of their needs and worked with their kind of counterparts and third sector and the local authorities to really cut them slack. As Vivian has said, the access, the demand on CAM services has increased. The additional funding that local authorities have been given in order to really promote the emotional wellbeing of children and young people through counselling in schools projects have really been really very supportive. We're looking at having third sector partners in schools that are promoting emotional wellbeing for all children and young people. But teachers and guidance staff in secondary schools in particular are very acutely aware of the children that they are educating who have those kind of exceptional needs that are above and beyond. And our experience is that they do wrap around the support, more particularly around about these children and young people, and try their best to ensure that their emotional wellbeing is needs are being met. But I think the universal provision in schools is certainly the focus has been very much on those third sector partners delivery and talking with children, young people in a very general way about good emotional health. And I think that is something that is to be commended and welcomed as we go forward. Having children, young people talking about how they're thinking and feeling and how they're coping with situations is the way forward.
Thanks, Linda. Can I bring Laura in to follow up on that, please?
Thanks, convener. Just to pick up on your point about schools knowing who young carers are, who are looked after by kinship carers. I agree with Linda. I think what we have to be careful about is whether or not is asking children and young people whether they want that to be not. Some children and young people wouldn't necessarily like the idea of teachers knowing their home circumstances. And in terms of the UNCRC, we have to be very careful about making sure that we take into account the views of young people and what they decide should be known about their circumstances.
OK, thank you all. Just before we conclude, I want to pick up on a point that we haven't fully covered. The whole Family Wellbeing Fund was included in the Programme for Government 21-22. And while it's not solely focused on kinship care, it is aimed at tackling issues faced by families before they need crisis intervention. So I'm just looking to ask the panel how you believe the whole Family Wellbeing Fund might be used to offer improved support to kinship families. And if I could come to Vivian first, first of all, please.
I said earlier that family support was an incredibly important part of the support that is available to kinship carers, and that was where the link that I would make to the whole family funding that has been coming. If we get family support right from early years and early intervention right the way through a child's life, then, and we get the support to those who are looking after those children right, then actually far fewer young people will need to be looked after and will need to be looked after in kinship care or foster care or any other type of care setting. So I think the fund is incredibly important. My one comment would be that it can sometimes be too, if it's too targeted, then it might mitigate the effect of being able to meet everybody's needs right the way across. There are some very specific supports that are needed for kinship carers. They need help to look after children who have gone through trauma. They need to be able to access the right person to direct them in the right place for issues which might not be around for other families of who are not looking after a child in kinship care. But actually, if we get the family support aspect of things right, then it could transform the opportunities and the support that is available to kinship carers. So from that point of view, that funding is incredibly important, and it's going to target one of the key parts of the promise.
Thank you very much, Vivian. Could I bring Laura in that point as well, please?
Certainly. COSLA's been working really closely with Scottish Government on this, the purpose of the investment to provide that upstream early support for crisis support for children, young people and families, and that's welcomed in terms of our work to keep the promise. There's a family support delivery group that's a collective of Scottish Government, local government, health, third sector, professional associations and academics, and they've developed a route map for family support, and that will feed into and advise future years of the whole family wellbeing fund. So the committee might be interested in looking into the work of that group and linking in with that and looking at how they can influence that.
Thank you very much. Okay, that brings us to the end. I don't believe anyone else wants to come in on that. So can I just say thank you very much to all of the panel for giving your evidence this morning. Your answers and comments have been extremely helpful. And just want to remind you that if there is anything that you feel you may have missed, you are more than welcome to follow up on any points in writing. So thanks once again. We'll suspend the meeting briefly just for the change of panels, and we will have a short 5-minute comfort break. Thank you. Hello everyone, thank you and welcome back. We will now continue taking evidence on kinship care. The format of this session will be the same as the previous panel. I welcome to the meeting our second panel, who are also joining us remotely. First we have, can I just confirm it's Micheline? Is that how I pronounce?
Yes, Micheline.
Micheline, perfect, thank you. Micheline, Chair of the Scottish Kinship Care Alliance, Jill Westwood, Peebles and District Citizens Advice Bureau Manager, and Alison Gillis, Child Poverty Action Group in Scotland. Hopefully you've all had the opportunity to tune into the previous session and we'll have an idea of the issues that have already been highlighted this morning. Once again, I just want to go over a few housekeeping points. Please allow our broadcasting colleagues a few seconds to turn your microphones on before you start to speak. Witnesses can indicate with an R in the dialogue box in blue jeans or simply with a show of your hand if you wish to come in a question, and everyone should check that they can see the dialogue box on the right hand of your screen at the moment. I would urge you all to be mindful of time. We're not too bad for time. I'll keep an eye on that as we go through, but we do have a lot to get through. Please don't feel you have to answer every single question. If you've nothing new to add to what's been said by others, it really is okay. And obviously, you're also welcome to follow up in writing on any points that you don't feel have been covered, or if you want to supply any further information on any point raised after the meeting. I would also invite members to direct their question to particular panellists. And again, I will invite members to ask questions in turn. We will begin again with Jeremy Balfour to be followed by Marie McNair.
Good morning, panel, and thank you for giving up time to come and answer our questions. As the Deputy Convener said, hopefully you got to watch the first session so you know roughly where we're going in the next few minutes. So can I start with that general question I asked previously? Maybe Jill and then Alison and then we can maybe start. And that is in regard to definitions, in regard to, is it a problem financially having different definitions? And if so, is it easier just to have one definition, or what would you see as a solution?
I think the three definitions, or two definitions rather, make it very, very complicated for kinship carers to navigate the not only the financial entitlements through kinship care lines, but also the impact that those then have, the knock-on effect that those have on their access to other UK state benefits. So I think if there could be a streamlining of the system, or even just more simple terminology, that would be a huge benefit to kinship carers. Formally looked after or not looked after is great for social workers and for professionals, but it doesn't translate into people who are dealing with children experiencing trauma and having to experience a bit of trauma themselves in trying to help children. I think if there was some way of streamlining that, the other phrase, the other terminology that's used is looked after and not looked after. And kinship carers, in my experience, have said to me, well, that doesn't actually mean anything to them. The children are all looked after because they're being looked after by them, if that makes sense. So I think if the terminology could be streamlined, it would make sense to kinship carers to have it more in a more straightforward form.
Alison.
Hi, thanks. Yes, I agree. I think there is an issue with the use of definitions, formal, informal. There's also other phrases that are used. Jill just mentioned looked after, non-looked after, and the distinction there. And also sometimes the term approved kinship carer is also used. And I'm coming at this from a welfare rights point of view. So in terms of entitlements to social security benefits, quite a lot of that terminology is not helpful when you're trying to, if you're a kinship carer, trying to ascertain what benefits you might be entitled to, or indeed if you're an advisor trying to advise somebody. Actually, from a benefits point of view, what you need to know is whether the child is a looked after child or not. That's the crucial bit of information quite often in terms of welfare benefits. And if you use the terminology formal and informal, it doesn't necessarily equate to looked after, non-looked after, as you've already gathered. So there's wider issues about the terminology, which other people have spoken about. From my point of view, thinking about the social security aspect of it, formal, informal is not particularly helpful, causes confusion and causes people to get the wrong information, the wrong advice, sometimes causes people to get the wrong benefit entitlement or not get the benefit entitlement that they ought to have. So I think, to finish the point, inevitably there will be pieces of terminology used, for example, in relation to the benefit system. What I would like is for people to have greater clarity about the terms that they're using. And so perhaps a streamlining or a greater clarity, yes, would be very welcome.
Alison, I wonder if I could maybe just come back to you and just pursue that slightly further in regard to your role, in regard to getting people the appropriate benefits that they're entitled to. From your experience, if you, depending on what definition you fall under, are the passport benefits you get if you fall under one definition or another definition? And is that the same across the United Kingdom, or is it different? That may go beyond, and if it does, stop me. But is it the same in Scotland compared to England and Wales? And obviously the new agency here in Scotland is just up and running, so it's still fairly new. But I wonder, from your an early experience of a new agency, are they following that at all in regard to definitions, or do they see it all as one?
Okay, that's a quite a big, wide-ranging question. That's why I was making whatever face I was making. So it's not that I do know about the UK system and some of the differences that exist in relation to kinship carers in the Scottish context. If we're thinking, I mean, I'll try not to be too long-winded, but if we're thinking about the main UK benefit that people are now going to be thinking about, the means-tested benefit would be universal credit, but also we're still thinking about child tax credit because it's still around. And so in relation to that, the issue of whether a child or young person is looked after or not is really crucial in terms of what entitlement a kinship carer might have. So a lot flows from that, particularly in relation to universal credit. By and large, if you're caring for a looked after child away from home, so in a kinship care situation, for example, then you wouldn't get the child element of universal credit. And what that really does is it applies the same rules to those kinship carers and those children as would apply to a child in a foster care situation, if that makes sense. So, so the assumption is that the local authority is supporting the kinship carer and that child. And that would be the same across the UK. Those rules would apply across the UK. Where the difference comes in is some of the legal differences in terms of the kinship care situation or placement. But by and large, what I've just said would apply across the board. It creates issues and difficulties and confusion, and the DWP don't always get it right. And as I've said in my written briefing, to go to the other bit of your question about Social Security Scotland, of course, the benefits that Social Security Scotland are administering are not those big means-tested benefits like universal credit. So, however, I would say that the Scottish Child Payment, for example, which is obviously, as you know, just a Scottish benefit, it has no equivalent in the rest of the UK. I would say that in relation to that particular benefit,
which is obviously quite a small, it's significant but quite small. I would say the Scottish Government or Social Security Scotland tried quite hard to try and ensure that kinship carers of both looked after and non-looked after children who are on a low income can access the Scottish Child Payment. So that does show a different approach, but I suppose I have to say the Scottish Child Payment is a very different thing from the support that somebody gets from Universal Credit, if that makes sense. I could obviously say more about it, but I probably don't. That's probably enough.
I mean, that has been really helpful. I mean, you might, if there's anything else you want to put down, as the Deputy Commissioner said, please do invite in. And in particular, if there's any definitions around passported benefits, which people may or may not get, depending on the definition, then perhaps you could reflect that in any written statement later. But thank you very much. That's been very helpful. And thank you, Deputy Commissioner.
Thanks, Jeremy. I believe that Jill and then Micheline wanted to come in on those points, so I'll bring Jill in first. Thank you.
Thanks. I just was going back to the definitions question and would echo what Alison said from an advice-giving on welfare benefits perspective. If the kinship carer is not confident of the information they're giving you about looked after or not looked after status, we can't actually proceed to advise them because we would potentially be giving them completely the wrong information, which is a time delay, which means that it takes longer for the kinship carer to actually start to receive benefits and sometimes kinship care lines. So the kind of crucial timing needs to be considered as well, I would say, when we're thinking about definitions and clarity.
Thank you very much, Jill. And Micheline, if you've got something to add, that would be great. Thank you.
I agree with Jill and Alison. It's a minefield. So it's always been a minefield. But the biggest minefield came when Universal Credit was rolled out in Scotland, because Universal Credit is different from the old income support, which a lot of the grandmothers, especially single grandmothers, were on for many, many, many years. So they're taking off that, and then they've got to wait a month for benefits when they become a new kinship carer because of the law of the benefit change when you go from a change of circumstance. We've had a lot of that. Also, which has never been addressed, is the simple case, and it's simple to us, but obviously not to DWP, which is kinship carers aren't foster carers. And as I think it was Jill pointed out, a lot of the kinship carers go and they speak to Child Benefit when they get these kids and say, are you not the parent? And they say no. So they assume you're a foster carer. So they then assume along with that that it's the local authorities who should be providing benefits. And I don't know if the committee's aware, but when you get benefits for kinship care, if you get the allowance, which is a big bone of contention, then if you're on benefits, that benefit is taken off the allowance, the child's allowance. They don't get the full benefit. If you are working, you get the full benefit. But if you're on benefits before you get that allowance, the allowance and the child benefit are deducted from the weekly the maintenance allowance. So your benefit, the child's benefits, tax credit, child benefit, are removed if you are on benefits, if you're in the benefits system here in Scotland. So it's quite a discriminatory thing. There is a lot of, as was in the first panel, 44% gave up their jobs. So if you're giving up your job to look after a kinship kid and then you're having to go to the benefits system, then you're facing a minefield. And this is where there has to be what we keep saying over and over again, legislation, not guidance.
Thank you very much. Can I just bring Alison back in, who I believe has a follow-up point?
Okay, thanks. I think, Micheline, I just wanted to emphasise the point that Micheline has just made, because it's really significant. I think the committee will be aware that local authorities deduct so-called child-related benefits from the kinship care allowance, from the kind of starting point figure. And the idea of that is parity with the fostering allowance. So any benefits that a foster carer wouldn't get for the child. So this might mainly impact on kinship carers of non-looked after children. But anyway, it impacts on kinship carers. That's the point. So Micheline just said something really important about that, which is this, that the benefits that are deducted are things like child tax credit and universal credit if the kinship carer gets that. Kinship carer will only get that if they are on a low income. If you are a more affluent kinship carer, you won't get those benefits. They won't be deducted from the kinship care allowance. And the upshot of that is, if you're a more affluent kinship carer, you'll benefit more by the kinship care allowance. Micheline, you made that point, and I probably didn't need to reiterate it, but I felt I would. That's me.
Thank you very much all. I'll now turn to Marie McNair to be followed by Miles Briggs.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. I've put my question to Alison. Your briefing is really helpful. Could you further expand on the issues kinship carers have when trying to access UC and other reserved benefits, just so we can get it on the transcript? Thanks.
Thanks very much. Yes, there are some pretty significant issues. I've listed them in my briefing, and we've also got a fuller report which I've sent, which gives some more detail of financial impact. One of the significant points is this issue, which I mentioned already, about if you're a kinship carer of a looked after child, generally speaking, you will not be eligible for the child element in your UC. So that's the starting point, and that's a very absolute rule. Unfortunately, it's a rule that isn't always applied properly. So the DWP, I think I've explored this to quite an extent with the DWP, but not to an extent that's actually, you know, resulted in it being sorted out. It's to do, I think, with the questions they ask people, not eliciting the correct information in all situations. And so what quite often seems to happen is that a kinship carer of a looked after child is paid the child element in error. And then at some point further down the line, the DWP realise it's an error and the money is recouped from the kinship carer. All overpayments of universal credit are legally recoverable, regardless of whose fault, so to speak, it is. And so that causes a significant problem. And associated with that is what the local authority is doing in the meantime. If they are deducting the child element from the kinship care allowance, as they might very well be, because that will be their normal policy, then actually the kinship carer hasn't benefited at all by having it. And then they'll have been overpaid the universal credit and it will be recovered from them. So that is there's two main problems there. And it seems to have been, I think we thought it might be just a bedding in problem that would in time disappear, but it's definitely still an issue that comes up. We see it in our advice line service, so it's definitely still coming up for kinship carers. So confusion, basically, on the part of the agency that's administering the benefit. And there's the other issue that I raise in my written briefing is to do with the two-child limit and the interaction with the benefit cap. Now, this is an issue for kinship carers of non-looked after children who would get the child element in their universal credit. The special rules that say certain people are exempt from the two-child limit. And one of those groups are certain kinship carers. So that's great. However, if you're in a bigger family, say maybe four children, you're really quite likely to get caught by the benefit cap, and there is no specific exemption in the benefit cap rules for kinship carers. So I'm hoping this is making some kind of sense, but basically you might have the advantage of special rules within the two-child limit, but then you might find that in any event, your universal credit is significantly restricted because of the benefit cap. That's an issue in itself. And then again, it's also an issue if the kinship carer is an eligible kinship carer who's been supported by the local authority, then is the local authority aware enough of what's going on with the person's universal credit in order to try and work out what they should be deducting from their kinship care allowance? It causes a real complexity, real difficulty for kinship carers, real complexity for local authorities trying to actually work out what to do. And probably the final, I mean, there's more to say than this, of course, but the final thing that I would say is that I highlight in my written briefing, that if somebody's on universal credit and they're in a really straightforward situation of no other income coming in, and they're a kinship carer and they're getting a kinship care allowance, then the local authority know what to deduct. Mm-hmm. Because the person's on the maximum amount of universal credit and the amounts are standard. But as soon as somebody has an income from earnings, for example, that's no longer the case, or probably no longer the case. And so it really creates quite a difficult problem for local authorities in terms of trying to do what they ought to be doing, what they've agreed to do. And I guess I'll probably wind up on that, but just to say that one of the issues that I feel quite strongly about is that local authorities really do need updated guidance, because the guidance that exists from 2016, which obviously covered lots of things but included the kinship care allowance issue, obviously hasn't been updated to include anything meaningful about universal credit. And all these issues that I'm raising, I mean, they are difficult. Mm-hmm. There's no doubt about it. And local authorities are having to kind of try and work out what to do. And I think some are doing it really well. And others are probably struggling and not even maybe being aware of some of the issues that are there. And final point I'll make about this is the upshot of what I'm saying is that inadvertently, kinship carers might end up being supported far more poorly as a result of these interactions than the local authority thinks they are. I'm really hoping that it's quite difficult, but I'm hoping this makes some kind of sense.
Thank you. You touched on the benefit cap. Can you address the potential financial detriment it can have when all they're doing is just stepping into care for the family?
Well, in the report that I've recently done that's on our website, and I think we sent round the link to it, there's an example in that, and I don't actually have it right in front of me, but I think the upshot of somebody caring, somebody who had two children already and then took on the care of two children in a kinship care situation, and because of the circumstances, not looked after, but maybe with a kinship care order, because of the circumstances, are exempt from the two-child limit. And, so that would mean in universal credit terms that they would get the child element for those two children, and that would, I'm just doing a very quick looking at figures here, on a monthly basis be round about £470. So that would be, so they would get those child elements, so that's great. But then they would be capped and they would completely lose that and more, actually. So So in the example that is in the report, which is a realistic example of that kind of situation, they would essentially lose all of that and a little bit extra. So they really wouldn't get any support in the universal credit for those two children that they've taken on the care of, and that would be the upshot of it. And if they're being supported by the local authority financially, if the local authority is not on the ball in this regard and aware of this issue, and the kinship carers are on universal credit, then they might very well just assume that the kinship carers are getting the child element, mm-hmm. and make that deduction. So does that, that maybe makes it a bit more real in terms of the financial side of things?
No, that was very helpful. I've just got kind of one final question, if you wouldn't mind indulging in it. Mm-hmm. So it's the case.
Talk about it all day.
UC approach means that kinship carers have looked after children who want to work can be denied like financial support to UC for childcare. I mean, surely there's a detriment to taking on employment. Can you quantify the financial loss in relation to childcare?
Well, okay, I probably struggle to give you figures. I mean, I can say that if you're, I mean, again, in the report that we circulated, there's an example in that report that shows the sort of loss, as it were, of universal credit for somebody who's got childcare costs. So just to be clear, if you don't get the child element in your universal credit because the child's a looked after child, then there's three other things to think about there. If the child has a disability, you also don't get the additional bit of child element that you would get. So that's another issue. And if you're working, you wouldn't get the work allowance. So that's the disregard on your earnings, that unless there's some other reason for you to get it. But you know, one of the reasons why people get that is because they have a dependent child. So, you know, you might very well not get a work allowance at all. So your universal credit starts being tapered away immediately. And then if you've got childcare costs, that's the other bit of it, then you won't get any help with them because the child's not your dependent as far as universal credit's concerned. In terms of quantifying it, what people get in their universal credit, in the maximum amount of universal credit, or childcare, if they are eligible, is 85% of their childcare costs, up to a cap. It's capped at a particular level. But you can imagine, probably, from that, I mean, that's the figure that's included in the maximum universal credit, and then there's another calculation to be done about what your income is. But you can imagine that, given the expense of childcare, that can be really quite a significant amount of loss. And combined with the other thing that I mentioned, the work allowance, and again, I can, there's figures in the report that I circulated, but I can also submit those if that would be helpful. Would that be a helpful thing to have, or is what I've said enough? Because I can easily submit them in writing.
Absolutely.
No, that would be helpful. Thanks, Alison. Convener, I don't have any further questions on this theme. Thank you.
Thanks, Monique. And yeah, can I just reiterate that any further information you've got, Alison, would be very, very helpful. Okay, I'll now bring in Miles Briggs to be followed by Fousal Chowdhury. Thanks.
Thank you. We touched upon the promise in the first panel, and I just wondered where yourselves felt, and I think many MSPs are feeling frustration at it not being delivered, where you felt in your own professional experience the problems were in delivering that. And I think from most of the submissions we've had, it's where local authorities are being tasked but not being given the resources to do just that. So I'll maybe start with Micheline and see who else wants to come in on the question around the promise.
The promise, I attended the promise. I gave evidence at the promise.
When I gave the evidence at the Promise, two of the Promise people who were at the Promise left crying, because kinship care is real life. It needs legislated. You've got 32 local authorities working on guidance. Guidance is no good to kinship care. I wish that I could have butted in a few times in the first panel, to be honest, but what I will say is I'm here for the voice of kinship. I work with grassroots kinship every day, day in, day out, 24/7. Right? And what we need and what we want is them to keep the Promise. They made the Promise, so they need to keep the Promise. We fought in 2014 to get parity, and it took us a lot of years. And sadly, a lot of the stalwarts in kinship care, Jesse Harvey, a lot of the most impoverished groups, Glasgow North, Postal Park, Mary Hill, they stood up 20-plus years ago and tried to be counted. So we're talking 20 years. We're not talking 6 years or 4 years or 2 years. We're talking 20-plus for recognition. We're like the dirty secret care. That's how we feel. That's how kinship carers feel. We're discriminated against continually. I mean, you have a kinship carer come to you and their kids died, and they're told that they're a voluntary kinship carer, a voluntary. In 2022 Scotland, the place where all these kids are going to grow up in the best place in the world, well, that doesn't cut it, because there is no voluntary in kinship care. We love these kids, but we can't keep them on, love. We can't send them into a safe, nice, warm, clean bed and feed them and clothe them on love. That doesn't work in the real world. That does not work. So there has to be a universal, this status and that status and postcode lottery. We've dealt with that for 20 years. They're just regurgitating what we've said for 20 years. There's nothing different in any of the briefings, with all due respect to everyone who did them. There's no difference in any of them for 20 years ago. We're still 20 years down the line. We've lost absolutely amazing kinship carers who won't see the legacy that they started. They won't see this. We're continuing the fight. That's what Scottish Alliance are. We're fighting for justice for kinship. But in 32 local authorities, not doing the same thing. As you've heard, the money, the disparity in the money ranging from £77 to £200. I mean, how? So we're in Western Berkshire. I'm in Western Berkshire. And just to put it quite briefly, Western Berkshire ends and Cardross begins, so it's Argyll and Bute. So if you live at the end of Cardross Road, which is still in Western Berkshire, and then go two doors along, which is Cardross Road, right? That carer's getting nearly double what you get. And yet Western Berkshire are one of the best paying. I will give them that. And what I'll also give Western Berkshire is the bereaved. I don't have any bereaved in my group or that I deal with. And I do well with a lot of kinship carers daily between my own group in Western Berkshire and the Scottish Kinship Care Alliance. They get the payment. They don't go through this, you took these veins voluntary. They get a chap at the door. We don't get counselling. We don't get training. We don't get anything. We get kids. And there's human emotion involved in taking every single one of these kids. And they need to take that into account, because it isn't just about money. It's about getting it right for every single kinship child and every single family, and they all deserve to be the same. But it's not being kept in the Promise just now. We're still fighting. We're still fighting.
Thank you for that very powerful testimony, Ms. Shillin. And do any of the others want to come in on that point, on that question?
I believe Jill wanted to come in. I'll bring Jill in. Thanks.
Thank you. I think Micheline almost said everything I was going to say, but what I wanted to add was, again, from my own experience, I should actually say I'm here as the manager of Peebles and Districts CAB, but prior to that, I managed the Kinship Care Service for Citizens Advice Scotland, and I was a caseworker. It's just to add that foster carers know they're going to be foster carers. Kinship carers get, as Micheline says, the knock on the door, and it's very often they don't get very long to decide whether or not they're able physically or financially to take on the care of a kinship care child. but I don't know a single kinship carer who's refused. And that becomes, that's the start of their problems, really, because that's when they start trying to understand the ins and outs of all the financial stuff. And if you heard what Alison explained earlier, try explaining that to a kinship carer who's got, as I said earlier, three traumatised children and they haven't slept for a week. I think the information that needs to be given to kinship carers about the promise and about all their entitlements and their rights and responsibilities should be written down, it should be clear, and it should be delivered the same to everybody so that everybody gets the same information. I also think it'd be really useful if local authorities, and particularly the DWP, had a bit more awareness of kinship care, because that's one of the major problems that we've come up against, is suggesting to the DWP that someone is entitled to money and having the DWP saying, no, actually, they're not, and an ongoing discussion about it. So I think if some of the struggles could be taken out of kinship carers' lives, that would help them a huge amount. That was kind of, I echo Micheline's comments.
Thank you for that. And
before we go on, can I just bring Alison in on that final point?
Hi, I'll be very brief. I don't actually know a huge amount about the promise. It's not really so much my area, although obviously I'm aware of it. But I did note that earlier somebody mentioned the Kinship Care Collaborative as kind of part of that, part of the promise. And I guess the point that I want to make is that I'm really interested in the Kinship Care Collaborative, but I've not been able to really get to grips with exactly what the Kinship Care Collaborative is doing or looking at, and whether, for example, our area of expertise, the money side of things, might be useful as an input to the process that they're going through. So that's it. That's my point.
No, thank you. I think that's
a question. Question rather than a point.
Yeah, no, I think it's a very useful question stroke point, to be honest. And I think that's something we can maybe take away and pursue as well. Specifically, I think where, you know, the committee would want to focus attention is what does a potential model look like, though, to try to change this and get that right. And the fact that local authorities, and Micheline, you've outlined this, all have different things going on. It often will come down to who is one of the key people within that council driving services to change and also to respond. So I just wondered, in terms of what you would like to see that model look like, especially for informal kinship carers as well. I think that's something. And how best do you think that would be developed? Legislation you've touched upon, Micheline, but whether or not you know, a national rate is something which has also been highlighted today, and where that change should have been really put in place already.
Is this question to me? Sorry.
And just to, sorry, I whittled on a bit there, but it was around what do you think we should suggest to help change this, really? Because I think that's the key point we want to get to.
Ideally, we need legislation. Guidance is exactly what I've said. It's guidance. It's what that local authority can afford to do. It's what they want to do. It's the resources they've got. We're no blaming local authorities. We're no blaming any one thing. But what kinship carers want to see and have wanted to see for 20 plus years is kinship. I'm in the collaborative, just picking up on Alison there. We are in the collaborative. We've just come in. We were asked to come in, and we're about to withdraw. Well, we might withdraw, because what we've found is they've had 2 years. We've been in with the Kinship Care Service since Mentor came in, and then we've seen it Mentor, we've seen it other agencies, and it's a documented fact that we're not happy who is running the Kinship Service, who are adoption and foster, mainly because when we were looking for support in 2014, they refused to support us, citing total differences. Well, that's fine, and that was up to them. But then, if you're going to cite total differences, don't put a tender in for our service. because, as you said, we're totally different. We're not the same entity. So there's a lot of anger in kinship care about the KCAS, the service. We were happy when it was CAB, to be honest, because it dealt with the benefits. They were brought in to deal with the benefits, which you have heard yourself today in the evidence, is very, very, very much a minefield for kinship care. The modelling they need to get right, but see the modelling needs to be based on grassroots foot soldiers of kinship care, the carers. No data, not statistics, not analysis. Everyday life in kinship care should be front and centre for the modelling for any. Without us, this is certainly not about us, Miles. This is about data analysis. We've had all that data and analysis. We want action. We don't want words. We're out of words now. We've done with words. We're taken back to the streets, and we've not had to do that since 2014. We've engaged for all these years and engaged with Scottish Government, let them into our groups. They've wrote reports on it. And we feel let down. We feel let down because, see, at the end of the day, we look after these kids and we love these kids and we want to keep them in the best place, proven place, as care in their families, keep that broken, the broken trees off thriving. And remember another thing, if you supporting young mothers to get their kids back, their families are where their kids should be, which is what the promise is saying, they should be supporting families to keep their children, then we're a second chance, Miles, because we can hand these kids back and say, there you go, you're back, you've done what you need today to prove that you're stable. That doesn't always happen, that's an absolute, we know this, but where it can happen, adoption and fostering is, sorry, Jill says, it is a choice. You choose to be a foster carer. You choose to be an adopter. You're counselled, you're waged, you do whatever. We don't get that choice. Nobody comes to us. If you get a chap on the door, you don't get told, I'll be back in a week. You think about this. No. You have to think there and then. And you think about all these bereaved carers who are termed as voluntarily kinship carers. And now that is, as you can hear by my voice, that's my biggest pain. My biggest pain, because I hate going to meet up with a kinship carer. That was evidence I submitted helping a kinship carer whose daughter died. Why should you go to MPs and beg for help? Why should you have to go to do that? Because she's a kinship carer. She's took these kids on out of love and lost her own kid in the process. So doesn't get to grieve the normal human emotion. No mother or parent wants to bury their child and then take their children and then be penalised for it by saying it was a voluntary thing made because they went and got them. That's ridiculous. And we need this changed. And we need it changed the now. We don't need any more data or analysis or statistics. These changes need to come about and come about soon because they've got a volcano of kinship carers now. And that will erupt because we are tired of being the undervalued underdogs in care. Because we do a lot of caring and we do it to the best of our ability and we provide love, stability, and we do everything we can to break this cycle. We want to break the cycle. We don't want these kids being the next generation of kinship carers. We want it to stop. But to do that, we need supported. And we're not seeing this. We're still not seeing this. And that is a fact. And I've made that quite clear to the Scottish Government, quite clear to the Kinship Collaborative and quite clear to everybody. I mean, people look at me and say, oh, she's all... I'm no angry. I'm fed up. I'm fed up. I've watched kinship carers lose their lives, dedicated carers. As I said earlier, they won't see justice. They won't see this part that we're still fighting. And that's 20 years on. And it's enough now. It's enough. It's enough. We want to see action. And we thought with the promise that that's exactly what that would be. But you went back to it and saying it's taking years. It is taking years. And it's years we don't have. We don't have all these years. We want change. And we want it now.
Thank you for that. And, you know, I hope this committee is hearing what you've got to say on that, because I think all of us in the Parliament are disappointed at the real lack of progress which has been made on this, and it has to change. I don't know if anyone else from the panel want to come in as well on that.
Yeah, I believe Joe wants to come in. Thank you.
Hi, yes, just to throw in my top and trough, I just wanted to pick up on something that Micheline said. First of all, to say that I was slightly dismayed would be an understatement, that the kinship care service went to an agency which didn't actually provide information on benefits or the legal status of kinship carers. I think that's, on the one hand, that dismayed me. On the other is that the service went to an agency which is entitled with the one thing that kinship carers, in my experience, fear most, and that is that the children will be involved in adoption or being fostered away from them. That notwithstanding, I would say that any Citizens Advice Bureau will be very, very happy to advise any kinship carer who turns up, much like kinship carers ourselves themselves, with or without the funding, we will continue to provide the service. That was pretty much all I was going to say.
Thank you.
Thank you. I'll now bring in Faisal Chowdhury to be followed by Jeremy Balfour.
Thank you, convener. Good morning, panel. I really share the pain Micheline has given. I just wanted to ask one question to yourself. What could we do with the social security power we have in Scotland to help kinship carers, as called Micheline? And obviously, then my second question, and the main one was for the panel, is what barriers exist to kinship carers gaining the benefits to which they are entitled, and what problems exist with the current system of entitlements? Obviously, the first question was for Micheline. What can we do if we can?
Regarding social security benefits, well, we know it was going to be devolved to Scotland to be in charge of their own benefit system, and we were involved in the talks about that a way back, 2017, 2018. I don't know if I'm on. Am I on mute? Can you hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you.
It's a minefield for us, right? Because we get the same, and as absolutely as Jill says, we relied on the benefits expertise. We're no benefits experts. We're experts in daily life and kinship care. We do enough voluntarily. We're not waged. I voluntarily do this day in, day out. And I'm a kinship carer, a disabled grandson of 14, and a granddaughter, a 7. So when my granddaughter came into the process, because she was only young, it had just changed to universal credit. So it had everything changed. But the luckily thing for me, not luckily, but because my grandson was disabled and it hadn't been rolled out fully, I didn't come into that. They all get shifted and moved and penalised basically more. But it needs to be then a devolved benefit, or there has to be talks around the benefit system and how it affects them. Because as I pointed out, if you work, then you get the full allowance, full entitlement. Because, as they said, it's based on foster carers. But foster carers are paid to do exactly that, look after these children. That's their job. They'll get a pension. We're not paid to look after these children. We're given an allowance, some of the stocky ones, to cover looking after these children only because they are looked after children. Pre-2014, there was no allowance. It was a linked carers allowance, and you got that if you were extremely lucky, and it was £50. That was it, £50. That was to cover keeping these kids. They didn't have parity. We had to fight for parity, which we did. But the social security needs to have an act or a something. They need to have a serious chat around social security and the benefits, because people like Alison and Jill are always going to be inundated with kinship carers who don't understand the benefit system. they don't understand what they're entitled to, and they don't understand where to go, because it's a benefit. And benefits are complicated, as they said, informal, formal. Do the council look after you? Then they'll send you back to the council and say, well, it's your responsibility for that child. But whether it's an informal agreement, but remember, some of them formal are the residency orders. They used to be residency, and then when money came into play, it was changed to a kinship care order. Previous to the kinship care was a residency order. You'd residency of that child, which basically meant you were responsible for that child, and social work and the local authorities didn't have to take any responsibility for that child. Now it's a kinship care order because there's a financial element in some of them where they were either previously like children or at risk of becoming like children. So it's a big minefield, and it's complicated. And our job every day is to keep kinship carers happy and give them the best devices we can. But as I've just said, and we absolutely admit 1,000,000%, we're no benefits advisors. We're no DWP. When we go on a phone call to DWP, I'll be honest with you, they're rude to us, and they're arrogant, because they go by English, UK, other UKs, as they've said, the other Scotland, Northern Ireland and Wales all have a national allowance. They have a national, they have legislation. We don't, we have guidance. And that is a lottery in itself, because you're either in a good council.
Thanks, Micheline. I'm sorry to have to interrupt you, but we are just running quite low on time now. So I would just have to ask for short, succinct answers. I believe Faisal did actually ask another question. Before I move on to that, sorry, Alison had wanted to come in on this as well. Can I just bring Alison in?
Yeah, that's fine.
I think there was two things. It was about Social Security Scotland and whether there could be a role for Social Security Scotland in the provision of a national allowance. And trying to be succinct about that is quite difficult. But a couple of main points, I suppose. Number one, the main means-tested support that kinship carers might have to access would be, in the past, child tax credit, or for some carers still child tax credit, universal credit, or if you're an older kinship carer, maybe pension credit. None of these benefits are being devolved to Scotland. There is no plan to devolve them to Scotland. So, of course, Scotland can create new benefits. They've done that with the Scottish Child Payment. Whether there is any appetite to do that in relation to kinship care allowances, I have no idea. If there was, obviously, it would beg a number of questions, like where does that leave the role for local authorities? Do they not have a role anymore? In financial support, some people might think that was a good thing, welcome that, I don't know. It would also have implications for the UK benefit system, because, of course, some kinship carers, particularly kinship carers of non-looked after children, are able to access benefits like support for the child through universal credit, etc. Now, you have to think through then, can that person still access that support, and how does that interact with some new Scottish benefit that's serving the same purpose? So there's a lot of complexity to be thought through there. It's perfectly possible to think it through, but it's really important that people are really well informed about all of those issues before embarking on that kind of kind of area of discussion or plan. In terms of, I think the other question, which maybe I could just say something about, I've already said about the barriers. I've said quite a bit about universal credit. I won't say all of that again. The main barriers, I think, in a sort of big sense, are the complexity, the confusion, lack of access. Of course, people can access advice. There is the KCAS helpline, local authorities, CABS, as Jill has said. There's local authority welfare rights services, and some some local authorities have got really well-developed systems of welfare rights services that link in with their kinship care teams. But of course, that's not across the board, and people really need to be able to access that in a sort of what we would say is a no-wrong-door way, that you don't get shut off at, you know, oh, you've phoned the wrong number, you've contacted the wrong agency, you're speaking to the wrong person in this advice agency, you know, not having to tell their story again and again. So basically, that kind of service, where it exists, if it could exist, is really, really helpful at the point that kinship carers need it, because it is an area of complexity. And we might be able to do something to simplify it, but currently there's really no denying that it's an area of complexity, and that creates barriers.
Thank you.
Thank you,
convener.
Thank you. Before I move on, I just want to say I'm really sorry. I don't like to cut people off. It's just that we want everyone to get through their questions, and we want to hear all the answers. Thank you. So if I could just take Jeremy Balfour now, to be followed by Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you. And this is a complex question, but maybe a yes-no answer and follow-up in writing would be helpful. We've talked a lot about having a national agreed allowance and how it's different across local authorities here in Scotland compared to other parts of the United Kingdom. From your perspective, maybe Alison and Jill, would it be easier if this was administrated across the whole of Scotland, so there was one amount of money that everybody got wherever you lived in Scotland? Alison.
Oh, OK, sorry. It might be. Sorry, that's not a yes or a no. If you have one level, then the first question would be, what's the level set at? Is it a race to the bottom, or is it picking the best practice and going for that? That would be my first question. So obviously, that's a point that other people have made already. And then the other question that begs is, who administers it? Is it still within the local authorities, but the same rate of allowance across the board, or is it administered centrally? I don't know if your question had that in mind in your question. I probably don't have a strong opinion about that I could helpfully share at the moment. My answer is not very helpfully. It depends. But the first thing is, what level are you setting it at? Obviously, because the rates at the moment are so disparate, and there's such a big gap.
Anyone else got a comment?
No, I don't believe anyone else does.
I'm done. Thank you.
Thank you, Jeremy. Can I now bring in Pam Duncan-Glancy to be followed by Miles Briggs?
Thank you, convener, and can I say thank you to the panel for the testimony, and especially for you, Micheline, the way that you spoke of your experience. I have to say, I'm not surprised you're fed up, but the way you've just described what you've all had to be through, and the time it has taken to get action. So thank you so much for sharing that with us, and I hope, as Miles has said, that the committee and the government are listening very carefully to what you've had to say this morning. I have a couple of questions. I'll try and run them all together in the interest of time, if that's okay. My first question relates to the national allowance, follows slightly on from Jeremy's point. Earlier, we heard Micheline say that you can have a different amount two doors down, which I don't see how that is tolerable, and I can't see another way to address it. I would agree that with Alison, that a race to the top has to be the first principle on that, absolutely. And I just wondered if perhaps, Alison, if you could say whether or not you believe that if it was paid nationally, what would we need to do to make sure that everybody who needs to get money gets it, and specifically in terms of looked after or not looked after children? What is the mechanism we'd have to use to make sure that the discretionary approach that might be applied to make sure some people get money in a way that others don't, how could we do that nationally? In a similar vein, Michelin, if you could possibly comment on how involved have you and kinship carers been in the national conversation around the national allowance? My fear is that you haven't, and I hope that you will be. And so I'd be keen to hear a bit about that. My final question is, who put kinship care to the specific agency this time? Who did that? Do you know why? Actually, I have another one. And finally, I was really concerned, actually, Alison, at your point about affluent kinship carers ending up getting more money than people who are worse off. Is that guidance that needs fixed to fix that, or how do we sort that? Thanks.
Okay, shall I go? In terms of the first question, I think that, as I said already, I mean, if you're talking, I don't know if there is any plan to, there might be a plan for a national minimum allowance, but whether there's a plan for a national allowance paid nationally, I've no idea. But I suppose that if there were, then in order to make it work, the first thing you would have to do is there would have to be a decision about who is going to be eligible. I know this is really stating the obvious, but you know, the parameters would have to be drawn. Obviously, I would hope that they would be drawn very widely, but that would have to happen. So it would have to be either the same kinship carers who are eligible for support at the moment, or a wider group of kinship carers. But there would, sorry about that. But there would have to be a decision made about eligibility, and then I would say, ideally, that would be enshrined in law, because, in my view, rights are always better than you know, being able to point to your rights and to pursue those rights and to challenge is always better than something that's at the discretion of somebody else to pay or not pay. So I guess that would be my quite short point in relation to the first question, if that's helpful at all.
It is. Thank you.
I believe Jill had wanted to come in on this as well. I'll bring Jill in now. Thank you.
Hi. Yeah, I just wanted to pick up on a couple of points about national allowances, and it kind of ties into barriers as well. The first one was, what would be helpful is not to have three different payment mechanisms which all impact differently on UK benefits and access to other financial support. So if that was included in national allowances policy, that would probably be quite a helpful thing for kinship carers. The other thing I wanted to mention was, generally speaking, the money follows the child, not the kinship carer. So the local authority who places the child is the one which pays the kinship care allowance. That works out. If I can give you an example from a good number of years ago, when kinship care allowance was first brought in, most local authorities were paying kinship care allowance, but one local authority decided not to until they absolutely had to. A child was moved from their home in the islands to their granny in the area that didn't pay kinship care allowance. So the end result was that children from that child's home area, who were placed within their home area, were getting kinship care allowance, and the granny in the other local authority area that didn't pay wasn't. So she was getting absolutely nothing at the time. So the money comes from where the child comes from. And if the child comes from a local authority that pays more than the local authority in which the granny lives, then you've got, and I'm using grannies, that's a very disrespectful term, but generally it is grandparents for kinship carers. The amount of money can vary, as Michelin pointed out, from one end of the street to the other. So those are perhaps things that would need to be looked at as well. That was all I wanted to add.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. Can I now bring in Miles Briggs?
Thank you. This is maybe a question which you want to follow up in writing, but I wanted to ask specifically, beyond what we've been talking about in terms of payments, a new model around information and access to services for kinship carers, and whether or not there's a best practice model. I think we were all impressed with what we heard about Perth and Kinross Council this morning, given the urban and rural nature of that council area. So I just wondered, in terms of the whole package, and like I say, you maybe want to write to us, peer support for kinship carers, for example, but access also to local third sector information and organisations. I know certainly in my own area of West Lothian, there's a lot of good third sector organisations who are linking in, not waiting for a sort of referral pathway to be put in place to them, but actually you know, just helping people when they need it. So I just wondered whether or not there is any examples of that, that additional support for when people become kinship carers, and where sort of a model can be developed around that. I'll maybe start with Jill and see if anyone else wants to come in.
Hi, yeah. In my experience, when I was a caseworker with the Kinship Care Service at CAS, I covered 10 different local authority areas, and there certainly were some who were very, very proactive and quick to offer as much help as they possibly could, not only in financial terms, but also in terms of housing and support with social... social isolation isn't really what I mean, but integrating kinship carers into foster care groups, those kind of things, and some local authorities were less proactive. So I'm not terribly keen on the phrase postcode lottery, but actually it is fairly accurate that it really depends on where you live. And if that could be aligned, it would be really good. I don't know how you do that, but certainly some of the communities and local authorities were quicker on the uptake than others. And it did really vary across Scotland. I'm not going to name and shame anyone, but it did vary across Scotland.
Thank you.
Thanks. Does anyone else want to come in on that?
I think Micheline wants to come in on that one.
Just really following on from what Jill just pointed out, but from a kinship point of view, kinship groups, which we are the umbrella for in every group and every local authority, put in a lot of work. They're not funded by every local authority, and this is where more disparity goes as well, which Jill and that will be well known. Glasgow groups get funding from the local authority, but it's up to that local authority again, its guidance, what they've got, what resources they've got. But these groups take a lot of strain off the social work department, off of the departments, to leave them and free them up for other things, because these carers can come to the groups and be signposted to help. They also come to the group for peer support, which is crucial, because they need somebody to talk to. They don't want to talk to, with all due respect in the world. As Jill pointed out, and I pointed out so many times, they don't want to talk to foster carers or adopters, because we fear that is where our kids are going to end up, or we've had to fight to get our kids from foster care. So why on anybody's day would they want to be in touch with organisations that you fear? Nobody's going to do that. And that is, I mean, you've documented about what I've said, and it's no naivety that we don't need foster carers or adopters. It's just that they shouldn't be near our service. It should be for kinship care. It's kinship carers. It's about kinship carers. And these groups are run by kinship carers for kinship carers. And they get to come in and tell how bad their day's been, how rubbish their life is. And funding needs to go to appropriate places, not to people that are going to draw graphs. You can't draw a graph and take that to a granny's house that's just lost her child and say, oh, but here, hold on, I've got a graph in my bag, I'll show you. This is what they're going to do. This is what they're looking to do. That's no help. What we need is what I've said, and I'm not going to stop saying it. We need this discrimination against us to stop. We need to start being valued for what we are. We need to stop undervaluing us, but they need to put the right people in place to do the right jobs. And they need to have the right services who are designated to be that service, i.e. CAB, welfare rights, all these places that we need to signpost people to. We should be able to signpost carers to organisations without fear that that organisation will be against them or biased or any other thing. We need to be able to be happy, even if it's communities like Working For You, all these other ones that give local financial advice to kinship carers. All these, we have to be able to say, yeah, you can go there. You can go there. Because they've got kinship carers' interests at heart. And that's what we want. We want a model based on us. Our kinship, we're unique, we're no wage. But a totally different entity to everybody.
Sorry, Micheline, can I just ask you to wrap up? Carry on. I know you were in the middle of that, but just if you could wrap up quickly, thank you.
No, but what I'm just saying is the funding, what they're talking about, and the models should be based around kinship and what kinship carers want. No data people or analysis people what kinship carers want.
Thank you.
But they say they want.
Thank you. I understand Alison wants to come in this point. Alison, can I ask you to be very brief, and if you have any further points, you can put them in writing. Thank you.
Actually, it was to say that we didn't go to Pam's point about the more affluent kinship carers. And
I was actually going to come in on that at the very end. Sorry, we're just finishing off on Miles' question. Can I ask, is that everything, Miles? Apologies.
Yes. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, apologies. We did not follow up on a couple of points from my colleague Pam's questions regarding the involvement in the national allowance discussions and also which agency got the contract. So I would ask if you could follow up in writing on those points. That would be great. Thank you very much. Again, apologies, but we have ran quite short on time this morning. This has been a really, really interesting and informative session. And I just want to say thank you very much to all of our witnesses this morning. I know that this is an extremely emotive and important issue. So please, please be assured that your responses and testimonies this morning will definitely help to inform our work on this matter going forward. This concludes the public part of this morning's meeting. In next week's meeting, we will be taking evidence from a range of organisations that support women and girls who have experienced violence and to consider where the focus for prevention of violence should be. We'll now move into the private session to consider our remaining agenda items. Members joining us online should leave this meeting and join via the link in your calendar. And once again, thank you to all of the panellists this morning.